Buonasera signore e signori, good evening. Welcome to New York University, Casa Italiana, Zerilli-Marimò. It's a great pleasure for me to welcome to Casa Italiana, Anthony Tamburri, a dear colleague and a wonderful professor, to present his new book, Rereading Italian Americana. We put together a panel of colleagues to introduce the book with us. And without further ado, I would like to start by introducing them. Right in the middle, you have Josephine Hendin, who is a professor of English here at New York University. For many years, she was also the chair of the English department. And she was the first Tiro Segno professor, and she was also instrumental in the establishment of the Tiro Segno visiting professorship. Let me open a little parenthesis here. As you might know, that for the past 12 years, I believe, we have had the teaching of Italian-American studies inside the Department of Italian, thanks to this club, to this foundation that established a visiting professorship. But also before, the visiting professorship was in full bloom and the funds had been completely deposited, we could rely on Professor Hendin that really started the teaching of Italian-American studies here at New York University and that worked with me in convincing and lobbying the foundation of the good of establishing this visiting chair. Professor Hendin's scholarly work includes fundamental studies on Flannery O'Connor, a collection of essays on women and violence, but she's also a novelist, and with her novel, The Right Thing to Do, she won an American Book Award. She also won the Pietro Di Donato John Fante Award for Literary Excellence from Osaia and the Lucrezia Cornaro Award as a woman scholar. And here to my left, you have Professor Martino Marazzi, who is an assistant professor of Italian literature at the University of Milan, and he's currently the Tiro Segno visiting professor in the Department of Italian Studies here. And right now he's teaching two classes, one undergraduate and one graduate class, on Italian-American culture. He has been a fellow at the Italian Academy for Advanced Studies in America at Columbia University, and his most recent books, Danteum Studi sul Dante Imperiale del Novecento, that is forthcoming, Voices of Italian America, A History of Early Italian American Literature with a Critical Anthology, and Occhi Aperti, Letteratura dell'Emigrazione e Mito Americano. Martino is also an author of fiction, and he wrote two novels, La Fine del Purgatorio and Filogenesi, both published in Milan, one in 2008 and one in 2010. And finally, the person to whom this evening is dedicated, and before the official presentation, allow me to say that it's a great pleasure for me to welcome Anthony here at the Casa and to be able to rely on him as a colleague on a variety of different initiatives. And also to welcome to our auditorium a person with whom I see eye to eye on so many things. And you would have a clear proof of that when we get together with the other directors of other similar institutions. Wherever we are seated across the room, at a certain point we have this eye contact and we understand immediately what the other one is thinking. And it's a great fortune for us as an academic community in New York City to be able to rely on the work of Anthony that combines in an admirable way his managerial work, his job as dean of the Calandra Institute that he really brought to unprecedented heights in terms of academic productivity and excellence in scholarship. And also, he's able to pursue his own scholarship, and that's what we're celebrating this evening. Anthony just was just made, I think, a few months ago, distinguished professor of European Languages and Literature at Queen's College. As I said, he's the dean of the John D. Calandra Italian American Institute, and let me wave the flag of a competing but friendly organization. He's the co-director of the very, very active Bordighera Press, the past president of the Italian American Studies Association and of the American Association of Teachers of Italian. As many of you know, Anthony comes from Italian studies. He's got his PhD in Italian literature at Berkeley, and he has authored several books within the past 10 years only, Una semiotica della rilettura, Guido Gozzano, Aldo Palazzeschi, Italo Calvino, and then narrare altrove diverse segnalature letterarie, una semiotica dell'etnicità, nuove segnalature per la letteratura italo-americana, and then reviewing Italian-Americana generalities and specificities on cinema. That would be the sort of preview of these, the first part of the book that we, or the volume that we present this evening. He's the co-editor for the translation with Rob Biscusi and James Ferriconi of the English version of Italo-Americana, the literature of the Great Migration, 1880-1943, edited in Italian by Francesco Durante. It's a monumental work, and it was really a major undertaking on the part of the colleagues that translated and put together the English version, much needed English version of Italo-Americana by Durante. He's also the executive producer and host of the Calandra Institute's monthly TV program, Italics, produced in collaboration with CUNY TV, and one of the co-founders of the Italian-American Digital Project, which produces iItaly.org, and Anna Letizia Airos, who is the editor-in-chief, is here with us tonight, and she just completed an interview with the members of our panels, hosted by Fred Gardafe, that I cannot not mention, being seated in the front row and being also definitely one of the founders of the field of Italian-American studies in the United States. We're very grateful to Fred for his presence here tonight and also for having agreed to host the interview for the TV program that will be aired in a couple of weeks, probably on Channel 25. And without further ado, I leave it to my friends and colleagues on the panel. Please welcome them.
It's my duty to start, and I had no idea what I was going to read when I was first reached about 2 weeks ago by this very kind invitation, of which I'm deeply honored. Also, it's the first time that I have the opportunity to speak here as a newly appointed visiting Tiro Segno professor in Italian-American culture, so that I think is it's very fitting to be able also to talk about this book. And it was a book full of surprises for me, and beautiful surprises, and which gave me the possibility of exploring, I hope, new and fruitful ideas, and also gave me a sense of how how Italian-American criticism has reached a point by now of full maturity, because what we have in this book, what I particularly treasured in this book, is that it's twofold in terms of contents. There's a part dedicated mostly to prose writers and novelists, and another part dedicated to poetry, which is particularly welcome, I think. As I was reading, a number of points and thematics came to the fore, which I would like to just very briefly point out. I mean, things that I jotted down, I think, around which the book revolves. One is already very apparent in the title, that is rereading. Rereading might sound a quite common word, but has a very deep significance in the as we go on reading the book. Rereading, that is, in a way, establishing a canon. Then another word, which I don't know if Tamburri uses or not, but the question of the roots, the origin of all this. Okay. After the roots, the future. The future of this literature and the future of this cultural field. And that would lead me to the last point, which I think is as relevant as the other one, which is education. But before I try to make sense of these four focuses, let me b- briefly as I can, indulge in a short personal moment, because reading Tamburri's book also made me think of a very recent experience, and allowed me to go back to it and give it full meaning. Just before going on the plane and coming here, I ventured all by myself in one of my favorite escapades, which is alpine trekking. And so after a lot of preparation and the expected cancellation by all of my friends, I ventured all by myself in a rather hard trek on the Alps. And the goal would have been to go on a mountain path pretty high up on the linguistic and political point. Okay. Between the Italian language and German language. So okay. So I was going on this track, and it was on my second day, as I was walking up on a very steep path. I started in a village which in itself is a small monument, one of the many thousands of Italian immigration. This is a village which is perched halfway on a mountain, which has been completely abandoned in 1962 and is now the residence of three people, two octogenarians who were born there and by all accounts want to die there, and the son of one of these guys. And so I started from this village, and most of them went to Argentina. And as it is the case, that village and all the surrounding area had been inhabited and cultivated for centuries and centuries. As I was treading on this path, which was very heavy, full of history, I was actually redoing a Via Crucis. So there were a number of shrines on the way. And the first shrine, which I reached after a couple of hours already, almost exhausted, had a beautiful inscription, which read, "Il paradiso costa fatica, ma è bello." Okay, no need to. I don't think I need to translate that. That spoke to me, because even though it was like maybe 8:30 in the morning, it started very early, but it was a hell of a walk. After a couple of hours, I reach another shrine, which bears another inscription, and that really sort of shook me, because it said, "Gesù, Giuseppe, Maria," first line, second line, "assisteteci nell'ultima agonia." Now, apart from personal significance, the beauty of the lines, which have a rhyme, have an alliteration. But then I thought of something that probably Tamburri and Fred might have already surmised. This is the exact same sentence, at least the first, Gesù Giuseppe Maria, that what I consider the greatest character in Italian-American literature, that is Geremio, the father of the narrator in Christ in Concrete, utters as he is choking to death at the end of the first chapter of as he's about to die in a riveting and really mind-boggling tour de force on any account. Paolo, the narrator, or not really himself, but we hear the voice of the dying man, of the bricklayer who's dying, Geremio, and he recites an incredibly powerful conflation of the Holy Mary and Our Father, which kicks off, which starts with Gesù, Giuseppe, Maria. And then it goes on for half a page. So here at the very border of Italian culture, I was reading, inscribed by who knows when and who knows who, the very exact same words which in Pietro di Donato's imagination had been used by his father as he was dying. That would be, I think, my personal proof of how this culture we're going to talk about tonight, Italian-American culture, has such profound and deep roots in Italian popular culture, in Italian daily experience, being also imbued with Catholicism, or with a very deep sense and value attached to work and labor, devotion, gestures, and so on and so forth. So rereading for me has a lot of this, means a lot of these things, and roots, I think, also likewise. Roots doesn't necessarily mean a need of waxing nostalgic, but is a way of reflecting critically of, on where all this began and why did all this begin. What are the origins and the reasons also of our positions here now? Because also ultimately what one of the greatness of this book is also it allows the reader to reflect on the role and significance of this culture in this day and age, and so projecting us into the future and being also I have to stress a very readable book readable book and also full of personality and irony and also self-irony. In a way, it's an invitation for the reader to address this canon of writers. As I said, three prose writers and three poets. Then, you know, it would be up to the reader to make his or her own choices and to appreciate one or the other chapter. I don't think we're going to go into the details tonight, but there are an, also a number of surprises and interesting points that Tamburri makes, and let me just mention briefly a couple in closing. One from the prose section, which is the inclusion, and here I speak necessarily as a Italo-Italianist, the inclusion of a rather well-known Italian writer who usually is not directly associated with the Italian-American experience, that is the journalist Luigi Barzini, whose story, whose personal and creative trajectory certainly deserved the attention that Tamburri lavishes on him. And also is an interesting choice because it's the Barzini of the early days of the from the 30s, but up and also with some interesting additions in post World War II, is a very ironic journalist and really a great lover of New York and New York life. On the other hand, I found really innovative and surprising the way in which Tamburri treats probably the greatest living, one of the living legends of Italian-American literature today, who is the who's Joseph Tuziani. Joseph Tuziani is a very versatile and diverse writer. Tamburri focuses on his great collection, Gente Mia, which, despite the title, is all in English. And it's a beautiful piece of literary criticism. I would only point out, in closing, that this Gentania as a poem has the exact same title of what I consider the masterpiece of Italian-Argentinian literature, that is Gente Conmigo, by a great woman writer, Siria Poletti. Gente Mia is a collection of poems. Gente Conmigo is an epistolary novel. And that also should tell us something about the transnational dimension of Italian immigration and the way that this culture stemming from Italy has been able to produce all around the world. I would stop here for the time being.
Those are wonderful responses to the book. What struck me was that, among other things, it's a call to action rather and a call to thought. But I'll begin with action. And one of the things that is beautifully advocated in the book is the creation of a greater sense of intellectual community, where there is an active discussion of what Italian Americana is, what it should become, what it can become. And in part by evenings such as this and by Anthony Tamburri's book, it fosters that sense of a dialogue about why we have not had a wider fascination with Italian-American history, with Italian-American literature, and why it's only in the last 20 years or so, thanks to Fred Gardefee and Anthony Tamburri, that we've had an academic field which focuses on it, teaching these courses that I've done for a long time now in Italian American life and literature and film. I'm struck by the number of people from different backgrounds who want to take this course and are fascinated by the work within it. Why is that? I think you see Anthony explaining, I think, quite well some, not only the basic tenets of the culture, but the aspects of our history, a history that included a good deal of repression, stereotyping in a negative way, a kind of ostracism. It's hard to imagine now, but anti-miscegenation laws were placed in Louisiana against intermarriage between Italians and what was considered white people in that state. And as he points out, Italians were the victims of the single largest lynching that existed in America, where 8 men were killed at one time, not hung but shot, in New Orleans in 1891. Tamburri makes the interesting point that this history is an interesting departure point, a kind of baseline from which we can move forward intellectually to trace an enormous course. And as someone who's primarily interested in literature, what has fascinated me in my own teaching and what is, I think, very evident in his discussions of individual texts and in his call for a communal discussion among scholars, among interested people, among anyone who wants to read the material, is that it's a wonderful way of tracking the interaction between Italian heritage and American culture over time. And if you begin with some of the sort of basic readings in Italian Americana, Anthony has a beautiful discussion of Christ in concrete, and of Di Donato's writing style. There's a sense in looking at this from the perspective of someone who does a lot of American literature as well, that Di Donato achieved an enormous fame when the book was originally published. It was favorably reviewed by the Brahmin American literary establishment at the time, by Mark Van Doren being one of them, and it bounced the The Grapes of Wrath from being a main selection of the Book of the Month Club when it came out. And what Di Donato was doing is saying, why can't the experiences of an urban laborer, an Italian who speaks in this wonderful mixture of prose poetry that mingles Italian, English, and has the cadence of a kind of mythic, heroic poem at times, why can't that make its claim to being part of the great modernist enterprise of imaginative literature and new forms that are being created? And one thing you'll see over time is this ability to really typify the challenge of pluralism, the richness of pluralism, through this interaction between American writing and Italian writing, and the incredible hybrid that Italian-American writing actually is. And the way in which it discusses issues that are considered purely traditional, family life, food family pizza, as you say at one point, as the sort of mainstays of Italian-American life, but does it in a very innovative way. The family is really the shock absorber of American culture, and in responding positively to it, in interacting with it, it does some very interesting things. One of the things he treats is the issue of women, of gender identity, the whole idealization of the Sacred Mother, Annunziata in Christ in Concrete, or even Lucia Santa, who's too shrewd to be sacred, but quite a monumental figure in her own right, in Puzo's The Fortunate Pilgrim. And you see these women almost as in a generational succession, although their books are written not that far apart, less than 20 years apart. What's interesting about the treatment in Puzo's book is that what it does, and what you point out so beautifully, is talk about fatalism as an aspect of the sacred image of the mother as Madonna. When Lucia Santa tells her daughter not to go to night school and try to become a teacher because she has a good job now as in a sewing machine factory as a seamstress, she says, you know, when you risk something, you know what you will risk, but not what you will lose. And it's that sense that if you venture out of your safety zone, something bad will happen. There's a Sicilian proverb my father was fond of: if you leave the old ways, you know what you will lose, but not what you will find. And it's that sense of staying in that comfort zone. And it presents something in terms of the concept of women working and achieving an identity and some sort of economic freedom that is very crucial, I think, and very much something that affects even American culture. The sociologist Arlie Russell Hochschild has a book in which she talks about work is to woman what a wife is to a man, in that it's comforting, liberatory. It takes you out of the chaos of the home and family and into a relatively structured environment. Not that all work is always a structured and orderly environment, especially during the first week of the semester. However, it's that sense of an emancipatory, liberating aspect of it that sets up the tension between a mother and daughter who beautifully love each other, who get along very well, and who are each supports for the other. But it adds an interesting dimension to the kind of questioning of gender identity, of what is expected of women, that plays out in a good deal of poetry, in your lovely discussion of Rina Ferrarelli's poem, title poem of her collection, The Bread We Ate, that talks about nurture and nourishment, but also talks about the spirit of nourishment. And that whole idea of why shouldn't the experiences of, say, a bricklayer a laborer in an urban setting be as much of an image of America than the trek really of the Jode family in the Dust Bowl that Steinbeck was writing about, and to some extent to bring this experience into a mainstream of American culture. The call to action to form a community that establishes a discussion that about who we are and where we want to go and how we see where we are in relation to the past is one of the key things about defining heritage, I think, which becomes with each generation a little more difficult to do. So many Little Italies don't exist anymore, except as, you know, a collection of pastry shops and fork stores, and even the bakeries down in the village have closed. When Zito's bakery closed, it was a sad day for everyone. But in so many places, children don't want to live the life of their parents in running this kind of artisanal work and move on. What comes next? In terms of the predictive ability of this, you get something that is a major aspect of how we live now. And one of the many things I admired about Anthony's book is its focus on the present and future. That is, that sense of asking, why are we not more interested in ourselves? Why don't we make a greater claim? Just in terms of the kind of dialogue that is fostered in academic life and in popular culture that goes beyond the usual stereotyping. It's easy to complain, as some people do, about the bad image provided by The Sopranos and shows like that, but you don't often see enough interest in talking about the other things that are being produced, which are of a very different order. Anthony also makes the point that we ought to be bilingual more than we are. I'm fairly defensive about my Italian because I can't speak as well in Italian as I can in English, but I think he's right. And I vowed after reading this to try harder. But I think the point he's making is that as a group, we have to identify where we are in terms of the twin audiences that seem most likely for us. One would be in Italy. How do Italians regard Italian-American literature? Well, I learned something new from Anthony's book, that writers like David Baldacci, who is a bestseller writer of thrillers, and Lisa Scottolina, who writes wonderful mystery and legal thrillers, when they publish in Italy, publish as, what is
their first book?
Their first book, David
Ford.
Ford and
David B. Ford and Lisa Scott.
I thought anglicizing their names.
Although being Lisa Scott is not, you know, Walter Scott. I mean, you have come from a good tradition.
Sir Walter Scott? That's how I'm going to publish my novel, Sir Walter Scott. That's what I'll do. I tried Shakespeare, but it didn't work. You know, that sense of not getting the kind of interest we ought to. And one of the things I like about Martino's work is that he's translated a lot of early Italian-American literature and has written about it. Produced a wonderful anthology of it that makes it accessible to students here who may not have the language. But in fairness, I think Anthony hits on a point when he talks about becoming bilingual, because so many of my students have gone on to at least minor in Italian. It may be that they just want to get to Florence, but that's a good motive anyway for doing it. What else? I love the readings you have of poetry and of the ways in which Tusiani's poetry uses, while written in English, uses Italian a great deal as well. And one of the things that's striking from the perspective of someone who teaches a lot of postmodern literature as well, in my course, I teach the ways in which, beginning with Di Donato, through the beat writers, De Prima and Lawrence Ferlinghetti, Diane De Prima, and we get to contemporary writers like Don DeLillo and his masterwork, Underworld, in that. And he has one thing that certainly speaks to your point. There's a scene in which his main character, Nick Costanza Shea, is told to ask for help. And he thinks about help as a word. And he thinks how much better it is to be able to scream, aiuto, than it is to say help. And the way in which Italian filters through the book and affects the style and conception of his descriptions of life in the Bronx when he was a kid there is interesting. So I say it is a call to action to have more evenings like this when I hope everyone gets a chance to talk tonight. About Italian Americana and why it's so essential not only to read rereading Italian Americana, but to read Italian Americana even if it's for the first time. Anthony.
Thank you. Are you picking up my voice from this distance? Yeah, okay. Thank you, Martino, and because you were indeed, it was 2 weeks ago that, and you had to actually read the book online, I mean on the computer, because we knew we couldn't get you a paper copy in time for you to have enough time to read it. And Josephine was supportive from the beginning when I had the manuscript and asked her if she would blurb it. She said yes, and it's always difficult to say yes to an invitation like that, no matter how much you may know that person's work, because you never know what's in the 200 and some odd pages of the manuscript. And but she said yes, and she gave me a wonderful blurb, and I'm just delighted. But I'm going to start backwards. I want to react first, and then tell you what I thought, what was at the base of this book. The notion of bilingualism is important. It's one of the reasons why this book was difficult to write, because there were two reasons, basic reasons. One was because of that notion of bilingualism and a couple of other things I say in chapter one, which is entitled The Italian-American Writer in Exile at Home, Abroad, Wherever. And the second one was the other difficult or challenge in writing this book was the last chapter, Beyond Pizza Nonna. Further studies in Italian Americana, I can't remember now the title right now, Criticism. Because there I tried to do a dispassionate reading, dispassionate because some of the books I read were books of friends of mine. Fortunately, most of my friends whose books are in there wrote what I thought are really good books, but one or two I thought there were some flaws, and so I tried to point those out in a dispassionate but also delicate way. And it's not always easy to do. And I mention these two things because, indeed, one of the flaws was because of the person's lack of knowledge of Italian. Trying to use something that seemed cute, but it didn't work. And so that's the reason why, not so much bilingualism, but knowing something about the language, number one, and number two, knowing enough to know that you don't know as much as you know, and to be able to ask other people. Because in this one case, if this person had asked someone about it, then someone who is fluent in Italian and knows the language could have actually made the point that this person wanted to make, as I tried to do in my criticism of the book. The other thing, though, about knowing a language, as we all know, and this is a real banal statement, but that language is the vehicle through which we access culture. It's just that simple. And so if we can make our way through, with difficulty sometimes, but make our way through certain writings, certain articles, certain essays, and even some creative writings such as fiction or poetry, I think we can understand the culture better. And we can understand also some of the points of comparison to which our writers are reacting. So if you know a little bit about Italian literature, you can look at the dance, the linguistic dance that Di Donato does in a way that, like I did, and that is free and direct discourse that we see in Giovanni Verga's Malavoglia. Well, that sort of takes place here as well. It takes place in other writers too, but it takes place in Di Donato's book. And it's wonderful the way it happens in Di Donato's books. That's one. The other thing, if you know Italian, you also know that Di Donato is actually writing in Italian with English words. And so those are the important things about knowing language. I'm glad to see that Barzini and Tuziani were surprises. They're there, even though they may be, Tuziani, everyone talks about, there are two ironies about these two writers. Barzini, everyone knows Barzini only because of the Italians. And the Italians hate him, and the Americans don't understand the book, the Italians. And so it's unfortunate, because the Italians, in my opinion, is a really smart and insightful book done in a popular way. And perhaps it came too early. Perhaps 1962 was way too early, right? But Barzini did another book, Oh America, When You and I Were Young, which seems to have gone unnoticed. No one seems to know about it. A friend of mine mentioned it to me a number of years ago. I was in a used bookstore and I found a first edition hard copy in excellent condition. I started to read it and I just went, oh my God. I mean, Barzini is in this book because he himself considers himself an immigrant. Because his father, as he recounts, considered himself an immigrant, though of a different social class, admittedly also by his father. Because while some of the Italians came in the proverbial cardboard suitcase with string around it, the Barzinis in 1925 came not only with leather suitcases, but with domestics as well. So, but still, there was a sense of immigration and all that that pertains, that the father felt and obviously passed down one degree or another to Luigi Jr. And so Barzini's voice needs to be one of the voices that we consider when we think of this global issue of Italian Americana. Tuziani, and I actually wrote on a collection that many people had written on. I tried to do something differently, talking about what I call coincidenti oppositorum, the presence of opposites throughout his collection. But Tuziani is perhaps one of our most perplexing mysteries as far as an Italian-American writer, because he's done it all. He's done it all linguistically, four languages. He's done it all genre-wise, fiction, poetry, autobiography, criticism, and translation. And the four languages are Italian, his Gargano dialect, English, and Latin. There is still a small group of writers worldwide who write to each other in Latin. They write poetry in Latin, and they write to each other. They have these tenzoni in Latin. They write to each other. Tuziani has done it all. Tuziani, 9 years in the United States, was the first American poet, quote unquote, to win the English Greenwood Prize for poetry. Yet, people seem to forget about him. He's still writing today. He still writes wonderful. He's still, literally today, yesterday he sent me his latest poem. So these, for me, these two, it was very important to keep them in there. And I did that because of what they represent as far as not only their histories, but that they're still working, well, that Tuziani is still working today. And I purposely chose a first book, which is Rina Ferrarelli's book of poetry. I purposely chose the first book because, first, because I liked it, number one. And number two, I think that, especially within the Italianate community, when I say Italianate, I mean both Italy and the United States, Italian America, we tend to overlook the quote-unquote younger or the first or the newcomers, regardless of age. And as a result, they don't get their just desserts in a way. And this is where this book is really good. She's a really good poet. And I just felt it needed attention. So I'm flattered that I'm considered one of the founders of Italian-American literature, along with Fred Gardafe. But I really think we need to recognize three people. Chronologically, I think we need to recognize Rose Bazile Green, who had the courage in 1974 to write a dissertation and publish a book on Italian-American fiction. There are some very insightful moments in that book that are very germane to the discourse of ethnicity, to the discourse of identity, and for some reason, even Italian-American writers sort of resort to Werner Solers, who came around in 1986, and they forget about Rose Bazile Green of 1974, who talks about her own stages of consent and descent. She just uses different terminology. The second person, of course, is Helen Barolini, who put together the first anthology of Italian-American literature, and which served really as a model in some ways for what Fred Gardafe, Paolo Giordano, and I did with From the Margin. And of course, the third person who really sort of jazzed up Italian-American criticism, spiced it up, sexied it up, et cetera, is Robert Viscusi, in such both as far as the content of what he says, but also how he says it. I think that Bob is perhaps one of the most enjoyable critics to read in English. I really do. I think that he weighs, I know because I worked with him on the anthology, he weighs every word. So we need to remember who within our community did things, and we need to bounce off of them as well. So this book, I wanted it to be both analytical and prescriptive. It continues on the road of some things I had already published. A semiotic of it. I published an essay many years, almost 25 years ago now, To Hyphenate or Not to Hyphenate. And I really had fun writing that piece. And I was very fortunate because in an affectionate way, I say a crazy guy from Canada published it in a little book form. And it really sort of took off unexpectedly. But this book really is based in a semiotic of ethnicity that I did in 1998. And to some degree, it is a companion piece to re-viewing Italian Americana, which is entitled Generalities and Specificities on Cinema, as opposed to Specificities and Generalities on Literature and Cinema, Literature and Criticism. Originally, it was supposed to be one big book, and then I just thought that the literature might sort of overshadow the cinema, or the cinema might overshadow the literature. So then somebody might have wanted me to talk about the Padrino, the Godfather novel, and the Godfather movie, which I don't like to do because they're two different texts. They're two different works of art, and they just have the same title, the same story. So I didn't want to do that. And I would have gotten that criticism because in the other book, there's a chapter called Michael Corleone's Tie. So it was that. It was bouncing off of what I did there, which is to look differently. So this re-hyphen reading is not necessarily to go back, and it's not only to go back and read, but it's to read differently. That re is like a reconsideration, to read differently, to go beyond the historical, philological, thematic, and also biographical, which those of us who were educated in late 60s and early 70s in Italian studies knows that that was sort of the basis for many of our professors on how they taught us literature. The idea of structuralism came late to Italian departments, if it's come at all to more than about a half a dozen in this country. I don't know how many it's come to in Italy. And the idea of something like semiotics, of course, still remains a little bit of a bad word in certain Italian programs around the United States, for sure. The other thing was for us to abandon also the tribalism. I took Banfield's expression of amoral familism. I think we can use that to sometimes describe the way the Italian American community especially behaves, the way it comports itself. We have not learned, we compare ourselves to other groups, to other ethnic groups, which is not a wise thing to do because we don't have, while our history as immigrants and children and grandchildren of immigrants may have been difficult or may represent difficulties and miseria, as we say, and so on and so forth, we were not victims of a Holocaust, nor were we victims of 400 years of slavery. And so we have to really, we can make the comparisons, but we need to make sure we make them in the proper way, in the appropriate way. And so I talk about that in the first chapter especially, because I want those things that I mentioned in the first chapter to sort of resonate as the reader continues then to read the creative works that I discuss, and that the reader then also has that in mind when the reader arrives at the last chapter and sort of understands, I think hopefully understands a little better what I'm doing in the last chapter. So how Italy sees Italian America is extremely important. Up until 2005, they didn't. And I use an example of the Americanist journal in Italy, the Americanist Studies, the per excellence, Americanist Studies and Journal does an issue on ethnic literatures in the United States. And not only do they not talk about Italian-American literature as a genre, as some sort of a canon or anti-canon, they don't even mention any writer of Italian descent from the United States. And this, to me, just seems absolutely paradoxical for two reasons. One, those of you who are familiar with Italy know that John Fanti is a god in Italy. And you go, in the 90s, I will tell you, when Francesco Durante started translating Fante and publishing them with Marcos y Marcos, you'd walk into a bookstore and you would see literally piles of books in all of these sort of pastel covers, because each book had a different pastel cover, bright yellow, fuchsia, red, purple, and so on and so forth. Piles, literally piles of books. And of course, now he's in the Meridiani series. That was one reason why I thought it was paradoxical. The second reason was because one of the best prose writers we've heard him mentioned in the Western canon is Don DeLillo. And so there wasn't even just a gesture of sorts to Italians in America. And I was really both shocked at the ignorance and offended by it. And so I included it in an essay I had written, which then became part of another book I published in Italian. So they don't see us in a bright light, and I think that ethnic insensitivity towards us is also, I think, has been manifested recently towards other groups in Italy. And we know the culprits involved, such as a Calderoli or a Tavecchio, right? The other thing is Italian American Studies versus American Studies. The internet is wonderful. I went back, American Studies Quarterly. Yeah, the American Studies Quarterly. It's the journal, the best journal, quote unquote, of American studies in the United States. Every year they publish the president's message. The president's message can sometimes be as long as 50 and 60 pages. This is the great thing about the internet, because you can go on the internet and you can see the American Quarterly like 40, 50 years ago. you can access it. So I accessed the annual speeches of the president of the American Studies Association. And I looked for the adjective Italian, nothing in the last 14 years. I was hoping to find DeLillo, nothing in the last 14 years. I looked for the adjective, I looked for Italian American. If there wasn't Italian, there wasn't be Italian American. Nothing. I looked for Italy, nothing. And I was just surprised and shocked that with the likes of Don DeLillo and the likes of John Chardy, we don't have one mention of an Italian American writer by the presidents of the American Studies Association. Italian American Studies is something that goes back to Italian American creative writing is something that goes back to 1835, we now know, with a type of epistolary Ugo Foscolo novel entitled Lorenzo e non Olasca, written in English by a Piemontese. So we know that. There's a gap, and then we come to 1885, the Luigi Ventura's Peppino, and then we just have a constant creation of literary works from then on. That's the fabulous editorial work of Francesco Durante. It's the fabulous editorial work of Robert Viscusi to have decided to take on that project. Jim Perricone and I helped him, but he did the bulk of that work. He wrote the introduction. Every Friday for a year and a half, he and I met to go through that manuscript. He did most of the work. He would come with it already read, we'd go over points, whatever. Those are the things I'm hopeful. The reason why I'm hopeful, and I hope that this is in some way a hopeful book, I think when you said present and future, that we can see that also as a sign of hope. I'm hopeful that with the appearance now of Italo-Americana in English, and the other publication, which is Poets of the Italian Diaspora, that Luigi Bonafini and Joseph Perricone from Fordham and Luigi Bonafini from Brooklyn College put together, compiled, will hopefully open up things with regard to Italian studies that we can then deal with Italian American studies from that point of view. And I think if we do that, we can also see things open up with American studies as far as that's concerned. I didn't bring an image that, actually I've never used it, but I mentioned that Fred Gardafe and Paul Giordano and I put together this anthology from the margin writings in Italian Americana. And it was reviewed in Italy, and we were just jazzed about it. It was reviewed when there was still, for those of you who know Italian journalism, when there was still the terza pagina, when it was still page 3, not page 32 called la terza pagina, when it was still page 3. And our review was the inside left column, which was the prestige, the place, right, that you wanted. And it was great. We were also reviewed in l'Indice, which was also great. For some reason, the image that accompanies that review is astounding, and I'll describe it to you. It's the back view of a short, very much overweight woman who is clearly the stereotypical figure of the old Italian grandmother. It's the back view. And oddly, there's a little boy whose head is halfway inserted into her buttocks. And that's 1992, one or two, in l'Indice. That was the image that accompanied the article. It was smack dab in the middle of the page that accompanied the article that reviewed our book and then went on to talk about Italian American literature. So that was 1991. Hopefully things changed. They changed some, but still in 2005 we had the sort of, in the etymological sense of the word, the ignorance of Italian-American studies demonstrated by the editors of the Americanist journal Acoma, right? And so all of that is, for me, was part of the basis, part of my cultural baggage that I brought to the writing of this book when it comes to that. I'm an Italianist by formation, by preparation, by training. I became also an Italian-Americanist. I like to be cute and use the scene from Godfather 3 when when Al Pacino, Michael Corleone is in the kitchen, and he says, just when you think you're out, they suck you back in. Well, a lot of us, a number of us came to it. Fred came to Italian American Studies as an Americanist, so he's genuine. Some of us came to Italian American Studies as Italianists because we were Italian American. It was sort of expected. And it was interesting because I have friends who were of other ethnicities who would complain about the expectations of those who are not of those ethnicities that they should be doing this type of work or that type of work, you know. So the other thing, and I'll stop here, is that we need, I bounced off of Cornel West, and this goes back to the notion of bilingualism, it goes back to the notion of knowing one's culture, knowing one's history, and I use the expression amor proprio, self-love, right, or really not being ashamed of your culture. Cornel West on page 53 of Race Matters says, it's the opening chapter, the opening sentence, the problem with the African American community may very well be that there is too much self-love and not enough affluence. And you know, I read that way back when, back in 1993, and it just sort of, you know, it came back to haunt me, It came back to the sort of front of my brain after I published an article in 2007 in Italian, a long article on Italian cultural studies, et cetera. And it came back because I had looked at Acoma. I'd realized that Acoma did this edition, nothing, and I realized there were other gaps of that sort. And then I started to think about philanthropy. And how come, why are there no centers of Italian American studies or Italian studies in the United States that carry the name of an Italian American? With regard to Italian studies, if I'm not mistaken, this is the only quote unquote endowed center. Am I correct? It's the only endowed center. One could say the old Casa Italiana in a certain sense with Charles Paterno, but really currently this is the only center of Italian studies that is endowed by an individual that I can think of. Why aren't there Italian American centers endowed by individuals, whatever? So the idea of philanthropy came up, and you know, and I thought, well, and we always joked about it. Italians give the churches and they give the sports arenas. Their names are on, and because we were hospitals. In Chicago, hospitals, we know, because we were in Chicago, and there was Loyola University. Joe Gentile, the Baron of Barrington. He was a car dealer. He had like 100 car dealers. And he gave money to Loyola University for the new gymnasium. And his name was not just in the front. His name was on all four sides of the building. So wherever you drove around that building, you saw Joe Gentile. Good for him. He gave the money. I'm happy he gave the money, right? All right. And then what? The stained glass windows. Maybe, you know, you get an edge. If you believe, you get an edge, right? Into heaven, whatever. And then, of course, hospitals. As we know, there's no longer the NYU Medical Center. It's called the Ken Langone Medical Center. So, right? But culture, nothing. And so Cornel West's phrase came back to my mind, you know? Like, we got a ton of affluence in this Italian-American community in the United States. A ton of affluence. So why aren't we setting up centers for Italian American studies? The John D. Calandra Italian American Institute is named after John D. Calandra, not because he gave money, but because he was a state senator who was responsible for the situation to arise that the center could happen. And so then when the center was born, the institute was born in 79, when then Calandra passed away unexpectedly in 86, they named it after him. So some people who don't know New York State political history don't realize that that's not an endowed name there, but that's a name. It's an endowment in another way. It's behavioral philanthropy, if you want to call it that. So I thought The problem then with the Italian-American community may very well be too much affluence and not enough self-love. And that's where the notion of self-love and knowing your community, and that's where I also talk about knowing the language to some degree or another, taking an interest in it, and so on and so forth. And not being in a hurry to publish, because that's a problem in the beginnings of the books written on Italian American literature. They're misinformed, they're superficial, and they just don't cut it.
That's why your book is so brave.
So, and I'll stop here, thank you.
Seem to agree on everything and it's beautiful. I know you're also personal friends, but you represent, the three of you, three somehow very different backgrounds. Martino Marazzi is an Italian born, Italian raised Italianist who happens to have taken at a certain point in his career a very strong interest in the early part of Italian American literature, especially the one originally written in Italian. Josephine Hendin is a professor of English, Flannery O'Connor, postmodernism of all sorts, and came to Italian-American studies. Do I remember correctly, after you wrote your novel? Or it was more or less at the same time?
I was always interested, but as a formal interest, it was afterwards. It was in part because people would come over to me and say, it's a coming-of-age novel called The Right Thing to Do, and people would come over and say, my family is Polish or Greek, and my father is just like that. You know, there was a kind of generic authoritarian father. And somehow I became more interested in it. It was also a fascination that came because in college I was going to major in classics, and particularly in Latin. And that was a passion of mine. And then I decided it would be more interesting to study literature that was still happening. But I'm struck by something that you touch on, which is the defensiveness of an awful lot of Italian Americans about being Italian American or about what's involved in it. And I think Italianists have a little of that too, because somehow every Italianist seems to have to write a paper on Dante. You know?
That's true.
Is that right?
That's true.
Yeah.
That's true.
So there's a sense of diffidence before Italian high culture. And Helen Barolini has a wonderful scene in which her heroine, having met this famous Italian writer who later becomes her husband, is having a party, and all the Italians are so clever and witty and smart and well-dressed, and the women are so chic, and it makes her want to marry him to become one of them, as if this is something that you can only acquire by leaving home. To me, the interest is how incredibly polished a lot of Italian American art, literary and otherwise, is, and whether it's rooted in a working class experience or not. The depth, the sophistication of it is fascinating. Even Di Donato, it's about how the world touches the skin. You feel it, and to some extent that what you like to call the coincidentia oppositorum, this pairing of opposites, is something to me that's the reflexive relationship between culture and character, and each has an influence on the other. I would hope that with affluence, people do come to look at these productions of art the way they would other kinds of productions of art. Nobody talks about Salone or other writers like that who often deal with, or even Carlo Levi, they deal with some of the harsher aspects of class and life in a way that is demeaning. And I think Italians often have this diffidence towards Italian high culture.
Well, one of the...
Personal expression. Yeah. I have a PhD student who wrote a dissertation on that, and it was published by Fordham, entitled The Value of Worthless Lives. Yeah. She studied 59 autobiographies, some published, some unpublished. She found them, the unpublished stuff she found in archives in Italy, in the United States, in attics, and so on and so forth. Yeah. I think it's important that we also look at that. You know, there's so much work we have to do. There's so much work that needs to be done. And we really need to get Italian American studies. This is something Fred and I have spoken about interminably. Have to get it into the university. And it has to be in graduate programs. And it has to be in both Italian programs, and it has to be in American studies programs. And Italian departments, Italian studies programs are very often reluctant, if not actually they close the door and slam it shut. And American studies just do not know what to do with it. I would submit to you that if you had 100 Americanists born and bred in the United States in a room, and ask them who John Fante was, as they would say, they wouldn't, 50% wouldn't know who Fante is. I just anecdotally, I've had that experience. To American studies, American lit people, you know, John Fante, who? Yeah. So, you know, we don't support in the most basic of ways. Two issues, the issue before, of voices in Italian Americana. We had 30 contributors, 12 were subscribers. Yet they want to publish in a journal, but you don't subscribe to keep the journal going. And so if we don't do it there, and if, you know, I mean, there are two issues. One, others won't do it. And two, we don't have a model for others to do it. And so there is this schizophrenia with, I think, in our community. You know the players, some of the players we could talk about, you know, but there's this schizophrenia in the community. And we don't want to allow room for other people. We use fare lo spaccone, you know, that's what I do. We wanna go. The perfect example, when I try to tell people who have seen Love and Anarchy, no, who have seen Sette Bellezze, the perfect example of the stereotype of the old spaccone immigrant is when Pasqualino Sette Bellezze walks down the stairs. That could be in Stamford, Connecticut. It could have been in Greenwich Village, and it could be anywhere. That's exactly, you know, that's the metaphor for me for the sort of negative behavior. It's that. We're not generous with all of that stuff, and we're not truthful, and that's the other issue. And that's why it was hard to write that last chapter, but I made sort of a commitment. You know, I'm at a certain point in my career where I can also afford to write that chapter. Let's be honest. Let's be practical. I'll be practical about it. You know, although I did it 12 years ago, but I mean it. You know. Once you become a full professor, once you become, maybe you can do that. But we don't do it, and we have to do it. And I have seen very few critical. They don't have to be negative. They can be critical, and they can also be praise. I've seen very few critical reviews of works or of conferences, et cetera, in Italian or Italian-American journals. Very few, very few. Yeah. So if we don't have, you know, an honest dialogue amongst ourselves, how can we expect other people to look at us in a certain way, number one? Number two, how can we expect to move forward and develop? We're lucky. I mean, look, when you look at sociology, as you know, and history has a long tradition, right, in research and published works, et cetera. Literature is the young field. Literary criticism is the young. Literature is not the young field. That's what people don't understand. And that's one of the most important things about Rosa Bazzilli Green's book is the bibliography, because she has novels that date back to 1911 that were published by really good presses at the time in the United States. You know, so that right there belies all sorts of false notions, right? Notions about Italian American literature not being productive, a productive field, number one. Think about that. In spite of all the work that was done sociologically, historically, et cetera, right, by a number of writers, in literature, Rosa Bazzilli Green comes along in 1974, and we have to wait until 1996 for the second book, which is Fred's book. I mean, and then, of course, these things sprout up like mushrooms at a certain point, and some of them are not that good, right? But nobody wants to say some of them are not that good. They're not that good. So, you know, so let's show why they're not that good so that the next person does a better book, and so on and so forth. So in literature, we've got about a half dozen books. I'm talking about only those in the United States. I'm not talking about the Italians. So in literature, we have only about a half dozen books, maybe, that make it. Yeah, even though right now, there are about 30, something like that. In my opinion, you know, my opinion may be a harsh one at this point.
You were going to say?
Yeah, no, I was going to say that I mean, I can relate to most of the things that you've just said, and also from a point of view of personal experience. For instance, I remember just a few months ago, I went to this pretty big conference at the University of Padua on the history of Italian American. It was a historical conference on the history of Italian America, attended by historians and sociologists, and I was the only literary guy, and the question was, oh, what are you doing here? Well, yeah. You know, I'm interested.
You weren't even an Americanist, you're an Italianist.
No, but having said that, I also find, from an Italian perspective, I find the field of Italian Americana quite refreshing and energizing, because you do have many. You might have issues and problems, and you certainly you have to grow and establish the field. But you know, you keep talking of a community. You do have a community, and the problem might be reaching out to the community, convincing them, and all that. As an Italianist, we don't have any community. You know, as scholars of Italian studies in Italy, I mean, it's so diluted, if you want. The old Croceon or Gramscian concept of you know, that literature is something which is relevant, is important, is, you know, by far now completely has been proven wrong. Literary studies, literati, don't mean absolutely anything in Italian culture. They don't have any relevance. They think they have some relevance, but actually they don't have any. So it is a bit problematic to be, you know, it's not those were things, but we don't really have an audience. Whereas, to go back to Gramsci, if you want, you know, Gramsci was fantasizing about a letteratura nazional popolare, which never was never the case and never happened. that letteratura nazionale popolare, I contend, in some way did happen in the Little Italies and became a letteratura coloniale popolare. Mm. And in some way it did happen, and it did speak to the communities here. So, you know, these are what brings me here also in a way and keeps me, having said that, on a funnier note, at some point, I'm trying to extricate myself from Italian Americana as much as I can because it doesn't lead me anywhere. So I ended up writing a book on Dante. It's the only ticket. Paradiso costa fatica. I don't know if it's bello, but costa fatica. So you have to go back to Dante. Yeah. But also I inserted a chapter on Dante.
In
Italian American. Yeah. I couldn't help it.
Well, you know, I think when I think of when I was in, you know, studying in the Italian University, a lot of the professors, a notable number of professors were also sort of public writers. They were journalists, you know. It doesn't happen as much today. Or maybe it's the newspapers that don't carry as much cultural stuff as before. But I remember, you know, you didn't have to wait until Sunday to get Tutto Libri, but you had like mini Tutto Libris, you know, along the way. I'm talking about the 70s. Mm-hmm. And in 60s and 70s. And so you had that stuff. The terza pagina was the terza pagina, right? And so on and so forth. And I think when, you know, newspapers did away with that, it was a negative move, mm-hmm. to remove that page from where it was. It meant that it's no longer important. It's not going to be. Think about it. It's the first thing you saw. It's the right-hand page. You opened the newspaper. It's the right-hand page. It's the first thing you saw. Culture was no longer the first thing you saw after the front page. Mm-hmm. It was relegated to where it's now. It's like just before sports. It's after Economia, and it's before sports, right? So that's where culture now is in the Italian newspaper. So the professors themselves have sort of, I think, retreated into mm-hmm. a little bit of a shell, you know, that perhaps they weren't before.
Well, if you don't have any more questions, I would like to remind you that we have copies of Andrei Tamburri's book upstairs for sale, and he'll sign them for you. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank again my colleagues here for a wonderful discussion, very engaging. As you know, almost all the events we do, we record, and we put online in about a week. So if what you heard tonight is of interest to you, you might want to check back on our website and send the link to the discussion to anybody you think would be interested in listening to it. Thank you again very much for being here.